Shahrukh, perhaps the one cliche, as it were, that could describe this moment is all's well that ends well. But before we get to the happy part, there's got to be many moments along this rather bumpy ride that you probably felt it wasn't going to end too well.
No, this is a joke. You use the wrong lyrics of a song. As a joke, I'm saying, all's well that ends well. I've never felt things will go wrong. I think that is, I mean, I do what I feel like. I behave like I feel like. I say what I feel like. And
get into a lot of trouble. A
lot of trouble. I've told you last time also. I'm a nuisance. I'm a trouble child.
To whom? Nuisance to everyone. Family, to your friends, to people?
I'm a nuisance child to my children. You know, the other night, in one of the fights that I got into, which I don't remember which one now. I've done so many this year. But
you're joking, right?
How
many can you count?
You know, now I've decided, I promised myself. And then
there's Shirish Gujar.
But I decided.
Are there more?
No, one a year now I've decided.
One a year, okay.
I've fixed my quota.
That's
now.
That's controllable.
Just controllable, yeah. So the second fight I got into, and I came home and I apologized to my children.
This is the MCA incident.
This is the MCA incident. Okay. So I said sorry to my son and my daughter, and I explained to them what was verbally said to me, though I didn't want to talk about the unsecular part of it, because I never discuss that with my kids about religion, XYZ. I just let them be.
Can I hold you right there? No. Because you're saying you didn't want to discuss the unsecular part of it. So you're actually saying that what was said to you was a communal statement.
Yeah, it wasn't nice. And I stated right in the beginning that I wouldn't like to repeat it, because then again it becomes an issue and I don't want it ever to be. And again, I'd like to say it wasn't an association that I was fighting with. It was an individual who should not speak like this. And if the association does take a call, it's their rules and I will respect it.
Can I ask you something? That given the amount of criticism that you got from so many quarters for how you behaved on the MCA grounds, and you're now saying, I think for the first time, because at your press conference you only said that they were very abusive, they behaved very badly, they tried to manhandle the children, including your daughter. But you haven't actually come out on record and said that what was said to you was a communal thing.
No, I said unsecular in the press conference.
So why are you not telling us what
you know
this
why?
Was?
Because it just makes it even more pertinent that we have issues in our country which are communal. I don't like it. I get
questioning your patriotism.
Just a word which I misread, because I'm from Delhi. I thought it meant something else, but it meant something else. And then somebody told me, and I got really angry at that. And of course, the kids were pushed or whatever. But I mean, all that aside, I just felt pathetic and really bad that my kids had to see me like this. They've never seen me like this. My son only had one thing to say after I gave a long explanation for my behavior. He said, you know, Papa, I'm glad you didn't hit anyone, because if you ever try to in public, I'd bring you down.
He said that, son?
Yeah, I'm tough enough, which he's not. Okay, I won't say that, but he's a tough guy. And he said, you know, I want to push you down and not let you hit anyone. So I said, yeah, you should. And I'm sorry I did that. And after explaining long, I asked him, is it okay? He said, I have just one thing to ask. I said, what? Why? So I found that very...
Why what? Why did you react the way you did?
Why
did they say what they said to you?
No, why did you do all this? So I'm like, okay, I'm sorry. And my daughter was deeper, as girls normally are. And she said, you know what? You don't have to say sorry to us. You don't have sorry to anyone. It's just that because of what you do, later on you go very deep in depression. And I don't like it when you're so deeply depressed. So for yourself, behave well. And like I said, I'm a nuisance child to my children. And I realized that night. And I promised them I will behave better. No, I feel very ashamed when my children have to teach me how to behave, because I think it's their age that they should be taught by me how to behave. So
you're saying that you were provoked in quite a serious way with an unsecular comment, but you still shouldn't have behaved the way you did.
Yeah, because I'm to behave well in interviews. I'll say that.
In this interview, you don't
have
to
behave
well. You can be who you are.
Can I do one thing? I would like to answer some of the questions as what is the right way to answer it and what is my way to answer it.
I just want the truth as it's seen by you.
Can I do both, please?
Okay, the right you one. Can do both.
So the right one. Yes, I have reached a stage and age in my life and career where people do look up to me as a role model. And
you can't even keep a straight face doing this politically correct.
I'm just joyful. And because I'm a role model, I should not give the wrong signals to people. So if people try to provocate me or say anything which is wrong, I should, the bigness and largest of heart would be, and the right thing to do would be that, yes, I should not retaliate to anyone. In actuality, if somebody again did this to me, yeah, I'd bury them. I should not be saying this. I just want everyone to know very clearly that I'm not a role model. I'm not a role model. I've never chose to be. I wanted to be a movie star. I wanted to act. I wanted to give acting and make you smile. I did not set out to be a role model. Because role models are people who play a role according to the perception that people think of them. I'm not that. I really want to tell people that I'm a commoner. Yeah, I've got a big house and I'm very rich and I can make a mistake and I can be wrong and it's all right to be happy or wrong or right.
You're whatever just being
you
human.
To, you can be and it's all right. But yeah, I mean when my
but
kids
But then you still
down,
have to come back and answer your kids.
Yeah, now I realize if I have to answer my kids, it's a little embarrassing. And I mean, they never told me I'm a role model. You know, I'll tell you a strange thing. I've never told my kids. You know, I don't know if it happens in houses. I know of some people, but in my house, we have never talked to our children. Bade ho ke tum papa ki tarah banoge. And if I'm expected to be a role model, then you have to accept me that, yeah, work-wise, I might be a role model. But personally, I'm very different. It's like, I'll give you an example. I have never, ever spoken after the first time about the fact that I get caught at an immigration in America. I choose to go there. If I choose to go there, I will follow the rule. Why, when I came back, I did not even mention it to one person.
Even at that time, there was criticism that too much was being made
I've
of
never
the fact
said,
that you were questioned for 2 hours.
I did not say a word to anyone.
Would
I did
you
not
have
call
preferred?
A press conference.
Would you have,
no,
would
no,
you have
I don't
preferred if it was low-key and treated more routinely?
No, I would prefer that, can somebody realize it is my choice to go to America in spite of this? And I did, and I know fully well this is going to happen. And I still choose to go. And that's it. It's as simple as that. It's a rule, like, you know, you go into a holy place, you take the shoes off. It's as simple as that. I should not go to a place if I have an issue taking my shoes off.
So you're not offended when you're stopped, not more than once now it's happened to you in America for questioning, because obviously your name matches some list that they have.
Yeah. So either I change my name or, lose my fame so people don't copy my name. But to be really honest, I'm not offended. I'm not offended to the extent that I don't go to some place. But like if I come to your house once and you offend me, or I feel offended, it might be the regular rule in your house, but I feel offended, I won't go there. The fact that I choose to go there for work or for whatever reason means that I'm not offended enough.
So is the fuss created over it disproportionate, you think? You know, Omar Abdullah, for example, had said on Twitter when you were detained the last time.
Yeah, do you have dark
that,
glasses?
You know, sorry?
Do you have dark glasses?
Do I have dark glasses? Why, are you tired of the public light shining on you?
No. I read his Twitter where he says, why do I wear dark glasses at night?
So oh, I missed that one.
I'd like to wear dark glasses and answer this question.
Okay, I missed that. I missed that tweet of his. But I was talking about the tweet where he actually said, when you were detained, that what's all the fuss? Everybody or many people get detained at American airports. Why is there such a fuss every time?
Yeah, and he's right in saying that. I think he's right in saying that. I think he's all right if he feels. See, everybody's got an opinion. And
what's
he
yours?
Feels,
when you get stopped, it's
everybody irritating. I have a system problem. I have a system problem. Huh. That here is a system, a place, a country, or an organization, which we actually try to emulate in terms of organization and systems and processes. Once a thing happens, the American consulate very generously came. They apologized. They were very kind. And they said, you know, next time it won't happen. And now your name has been given and the I thing has been taken and whatever. I go the second time it happens when I went for Ravan at Toronto. The immigration in America is done in Toronto somehow. My bags were open, and everyone recognizes and they're very kind to me. But it is 2.5 hours of just standing there with your bags. And I had to repack them, which was even worse. And I had to repack them really badly and broke a few things. And then, third time again it happened. But my only humble request is that if some thing has happened not only for me, it could be happening to other people also, and it's obviously a system and a process error, it can be rectified, and it would actually augur better for the security of every place if all the names, see, if there is a wrong name, there could be a right name which is not being picked on also.
But you know, I read in the papers that Henry Kissinger, who was Secretary of State in America, was also stopped and questioned. So, unlike in India where a lot of important people don't get stopped,
no, that's
perhaps
not true.
In
no.
America there are a little less.
I've never ever, never ever taken this, and I read some comments. I have never ever, in India when I go, I have never broken a line. As a matter of fact, if you go and ask the Mumbai Customs, the gentleman whose name is incidentally Mr. Wankhede, he will say that, you know, whenever he comes, he's one of the few people who will sit there, wait, yes, I do request him, can my children go if they are with me? And I sit there, I open bags, I tell them what I have. I have that kind of reputation in any official department. I've never walked in thinking I'm Shah Rukh Khan.
One of the things that was said when the MCA incident happened was, this is the same Shah Rukh Khan who can't fight with American immigration officials, but was flexing his muscle with MCA officials. Basically to say, ghar mein raja banta hai.
Yeah, well, they should try and touch my kids in America. I'll show them. You try and say that to me in America, which I think incidentally is said, to be really honest. Without saying it, they say it. That, you know, your name is whatever, and you know, it kind of tallies with somebody else's name or with the religion that we look at more, under.
But you don't see that as communal, even though it is a sort of racial profiling. Do you see that as important? Are you able to make that distinction?
To be really honest, I don't give a damn about any other country. I do give a damn about my own country. And to be really honest, I have been brought up and I'm a little educated and I know how the world is, and lately changed where a lot of the world countries are also communal. But I think in my country, in my capacity as a person, if there is something communal, I think I should say it a little more, flexing my muscles, than anywhere else. But I'd still say it. I mean, you know, the authority is there and I completely abide by the rules and it's all right. I wasn't going anti an association. I was going anti a person who happens to be in that association. And if this is a rule, I'll follow it. But I think they should have a talk with that gentleman also. I don't know what he looks like and I won't be bothered or I won't recognize him again. But it's not fair, you know, to talk like this. And if you talk like this, say it on my face. You know, talk to me. And I'm not being a gunda.
But was that the tipping point of the fight?
No, I actually came down because somebody, and they told me later, somebody told me that, you know, the couple of matches before, some people from the audience had walked onto the field and the security guy was, reprimanded for that. I think he assumed the children who were watching the match, and they had walked on from the field, but they'd walked onto the field so I could take them out in the bus which was parked. I came to pick them up. And so I think it was the same kind of a feeling for him, and he was being a little more, strict than he would have been the day before. So he was pulling them out, and I didn't like that. And I just told him, please don't touch them. And he still pulled another kid, and I said, don't touch them. And that time the gentleman came from behind and said something. And I just turned around and said, what are you saying? I didn't even understand at first. I misread the word for something else. So I just turned around and said something to him again. And then somebody explained to me saying this. So I went to him. By then 4 or 5 people came to protect him. And they say arrest him and stuff like that. Which, I mean, yeah.
In not going public with what they said to you, aren't you allowing the narrative to, in a sense, or the dominant narrative to be, here's this spoiled brat superstar, used to having his way, flouting rules, comes with his children, breaks those rules, wants VIP treatment. When he doesn't get VIP treatment, shouts at the police officers. Because you haven't
Only in India, not in America.
Only in India, not in America. That too has been said. Now, by not actually elaborating on what was said to you, that was communal, you've made it clear it was one word, it was communal, deeply communal, not secular. But by not elaborating on it, by not actually letting people know how abusive it was, aren't you allowing the other narrative to define the incident?
I think it's enough for me to say that, yeah, it wasn't something that I think is to be said. You know, you can say a few words which are gali-like.
Which you did.
Which I did, yeah. I abused, yeah. But I, and I think a lot of people can be very disturbed with that too. You know, that, you know, you should not have said it. I was disturbed with that. And, you know, I don't want to elaborate because I just want it to end. Because it's just extremely embarrassing for my children to keep seeing this on television and reading about it in the papers. My daughter was not feeling good about this whole thing. So I'm like, okay, now just let it end. And next time, if somebody says this to me, I guess I'll just move away.
Now, in your home, you have always said that religion has been a non-issue. Did your kids understand that something like this was said to you? Did they want to know what it meant?
You know, because it has been such a non-issue, As a matter of fact, like I said, my daughter finally turned around and said, why are you making an issue of it then, if it's a non-issue? And that struck a chord. Yeah, if it's a non-issue, then it's a non-issue. Let people say what they say and what they want to. Just keep quiet. Don't overreact to it. What are you protecting, the fact that somebody else has difference of opinion about religions and you're someone who doesn't have, then why are you behaving like this? You don't need to teach them in this manner, because then you're succumbing exactly, the writing ways that occur when people talk about it.
There's one part of you that I'm hearing saying, when I had to come home and explain this to my daughter and son, it was really awful. And the other part is still saying, hang on, if I have to give you the truthful, politically not correct answer, if this happened again, I'd do the same thing all over again, right?
No, now I'll tell you what I'll do.
No, now you have to give me the real answer and not the politically correct one.
The real answer, I'll tell you what I'll do. What I'll do differently, if I get really, really angry at something, being a public figure, I'll take that gentleman into a public toilet, close the door so nobody sees it, and then do what I wish to do with it. So that nobody can take a picture with me like this. And
there are people who are going to listen to this interview as they have listened to previous interviews and write as they have written before, that Shah Rukh Khan is going through some sort of midlife crisis when he behaves like this and talks like this.
Yeah. I keep hearing, like
you heard a lot of that when this incident happened, right?
Yeah. Pop, what are they called? Pop psychologists. I heard lots of them, yeah.
What did you feel? Did you feel amused, hurt, angry when you heard this?
I'll tell you what I felt. I actually wrote it down, what I felt that day.
As part of your book that you're writing?
I just wrote it. I wrote it on on my phone memo. And I kept it because it kind of hurt me. I look at this and I say, okay, here are these people living in small boxes of judgment and righteousness. And I notice that box is even smaller than the 42-inch plasma television that I'm watching them on. It's so small. It's really small. And they symbolize my hurt. And I was very disturbed. And the hurt and angst becomes anger, which is the second part. But I'm looking at them and I start analyzing, why am I getting angry and hurt with them? And I'll tell you why. Because I'm a movie star. All my life, all I wanted in midlife and before midlife, before, from childhood, when I started acting in theater, all I wanted to do and all I want to do is to be accepted, love and give in whatever form. And I'm very fortunate. I'm very fortunate that I get chances to share happiness with people. By doing a cartwheel, so be it, letting my underwear show. By being maybe incorrect in the eyes of the politically correct, I can do all that. I just want to give as an entitlement. I want to give it. If you ask me today, Shah Rukh, you know, this show is getting too serious, can you do something? I do chamak chalo for you. I'm not going to sit down and say, you're not going to take myself more seriously. This is going to be the possession of the people. When Shah Rukh Khan talks, he should talk intelligently. I can get an intelligent look in my face. I can...
intelligent look? Can you show it to us?
Not yet.
That serious intelligent look. Otherwise, you're very intelligent, but it mostly comes out in the form of self-deprecating humor.
I can think before I answer, take a little longer, use bigger words which nobody understands. But I started feeling that I'm ready to give. You ask, I'll give. Without asking, I'll give. I'll do it. I'll do anything that you want me to do because I want to be liked. I want to be loved. That's the first rule of wanting to be an actor. And this is what I'm teaching my children too, or any young actor or actress who meets me.
But where,
first rule.
But where does the wanting to be liked and loved reconcile with the kind of bitchiness, scrutiny, criticism that you hear about yourself all the time?
I'll tell you. So I want to give. And I'm giving. And I'm saying, please take this. And suddenly, I'm noticing that after giving so much also, there are people who question that giving with different titles to it, that midlife crisis, arrogant, or big star, what does he think, where does he think he comes from, blah, 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 blah. And while I was watching all of them, I was watching lots of them on television, because I did.
You couldn't resist that? You didn't want to just say, I'm not going to listen to what they're saying about me?
No.
You can't do that.
To watch it. I want to watch it, yeah. I want to watch it because it was being said in a different tone than it happened in. So I was watching it and all these, like I say, pop psychologists, socialite in their designer saris, with wearing more makeup than the attitude I wear. I love this, so I'll repeat it again. Anchors, who look like overgrown schoolboys think that they're cowboys. And, you know, their brittle self-importance held together by their outdated ties, and calling me a brat and saying X and saying Y. And I kept looking at them and I realized, you know what, I symbolize their hurt too. They're not the only ones who symbolize my hurt, that they're not loving me enough. I symbolize their hurt that, hey, you know, I can't do a cartwheel. And not because I can't do it physically, because I don't have that many occasions to express my happiness, and not only express it, share it with so many. Because I lack people, and I do a cartwheel, and the lack people say, yay, good fun, we had a good night. Can I say one thing? It's okay to be happy and share it. You don't have to give it names of midlife crisis. So if I was 27...
No, they didn't say it then. They said it when you had the fight at the MCA. That he's going through an unhinged
moment. I'm analyzed every moment and every time for whatever actions I do. Like I said, I can't wear dark glasses at night. But so many other people do. It's okay. Now I said something with Jack Nicholson. I said that, you know, the sun doesn't stop shining on me. That's why I wear dark glasses at night. I said this in my interview also, and a long time back, many years ago, they make a thing out of that also. And it's all right. I guess now I have to get used to... Like I told you last time, Barkha, I'm getting more and more reclusive now. You know, there was a time when I was telling all the young boys and girls who had come to do this interview with me. And I told them, you know, there was a time when if I was driving in a car and I saw all of them pounding on the glass, I would stop my car, get off, and chat with them. Not because I wanted to get that extra mileage on press, but because I see they're doing a job. And would it be nice for them when a young kid came to me and said, Barkha, we got Shah Rukh's interview. So it would be nice, because I was treated like this when I was young in the film industry, that somebody did stop the car and say, hey, you're a good actor, come on in, I'll give you a role. So I do all that, and now I stop doing it. They asked me in Kolkata, they asked me here in Mumbai, Shah Rukh bhai, you don't stop and pose for us anymore at a party. You look disturbed. I said, yeah, you broke my heart. And is it okay to be a celebrity and have your heart broken?
But you know that there are those who say that it comes with the turf of being in the public eye. They, people love you sometimes for completely artificial reasons. Even the praise and even the adulation can sometimes be very far from...
Oh, it is.
You know, how people imagine you is not who you are.
And all the praise I get and all the criticism I get, the truth is somewhere in the middle. I've always maintained this. I'm neither King Khan and neither am I an arrogant brat. But but there must be qualities of both in me. But somewhere in the middle, not to those extremes. And but I got saddened because my own colleagues, you're my colleague. We're in the media, you know. I mean, I'd like to say, because you know, you do the news. Whatever stardom you get, being a news person, you can't take it seriously.
Of course you can't.
You still have to do the news. So whatever stardom I get as an actor can't be taken seriously. I still have to just act. You know, that is the basic thing.
What you're saying, you want the space to lose your temper sometimes, to have a bad mood, to have a bad day, to not talk to people if you don't want to. You don't want to play the persona of the
film star. I can't do it outside, like you said, because I'm a public figure. So I'll do it inside. So I find myself getting, like I said, not wanting to go to a lot of places. And yeah, I'll be very honest. Is it wrong, like I asked you before? And you answer that because you're a celebrity. How much of a thick skin do you have? How much of is it all right? Like if you were to be sad, do I not have the right to be heartbroken at your behavior? Or even that is not love. Or like my friends tell me, most of the actresses I work with, very gently and kindly they tell me, say, even if you're saddened, don't show it. Because you should just be smiling. And I said, no, I don't want to smile when I don't want to smile. Yeah, in the movie you asked me, I'll smile 43 takes. And I just felt, you know, when people are saying this, there was a little kid wearing torn jeans in one of the matches, and a white t-shirt like me. And I was walking, and a lot of kids dress up like me in the stadium. And he was waving to me and saying, Shah Rukh bhaiya, said, little kid, Shah Rukh bhaiya, aapne aaj phati jeans nahi pehni hai. And phati jeans pehnoge to jeet jaoge. So I answer back. So my jeans were, I wasn't wearing these ones. So I said, yahan se phati hui hai, niche se. And tu aake baaki phaad de. You know, you come and tear it. And the kid must be so happy. And somebody said, I'm showing my shoe to the people. I'm showing the shoe to the organizers. And I'm like, that is a wrong interpretation. And these people who were talking, they also take that picture and say the same thing.
You're not at all more used to it than you were.
I always tell people that if I lead my life 51% good and 49% bad, it's a victorious, glorious life, you know. But suddenly, I'm, I just started feeling somewhere, and I told all the kids, I gave them sweets yesterday. I have a new rule, which I started, that if you ask me a good question, I'll give you a good sweet. If you ask me a bad question, no answer, just a bad sweet. I wanted
to do a bad sweet.
Bad sweet is it's very pungent. I don't like it. I gave it to one kid and he said, "Oh, bother, chai at home." So, different strokes or different folks.
So, what's the bad question? I don't want a sweet. What's
like,
the bad question?
I can do it with you, but I. If you ask me something with the notion to make it just a scandalous or a headline, I don't think I need to do that. Like, you know, some. तो आपने जूता क्यों दिखाया नहीं दिखाया बोल दिया मैंने अभी फिर से मत पूछो मुझसे तो आप क्या उसको अभी माफी मांगेंगे अरे यार यू डोंट यू रेड व्हाट आई हैव सेड डोंट गो देयर सो दैट इफ आई से नो तो शाहरुख खान ने मना कर दिया इवन जो आई सेड मैंने यार इतना परेशान हूं मैं तीन दिन से ठीक तो नहाया भी नहीं तो आज नहाया मैं समरी से यू लुकिंग वेरी फ्रेश सो आई से मैं नहाया And then I said, oh my God, please, one of you guys don't start writing, Shah Rukh Khan, teen din nahaye nahi. You know, I don't make it like this. And I understand it's a job. I understand maybe it should be taken with a pinch of salt. Maybe it should be taken in the joke. But then when the joke comes to my house, I'm finding the shadow of my actions, good and bad, becoming too dark on my family. Mm-hmm. And that disturbs me. That disturbs me a lot. So I'm like... maybe I should send them somewhere else to study and just keep them away.
Is it that serious? Have you actually considered that?
You know, I just start feeling that, you know, as is, I'm very grateful for being who I've become professionally. Very, very grateful. I don't think there's anybody in this world who'd be as lucky as I am. For the amount of talent and the way I am, I just got so much more. The only fear I always had is that my children should be able to go beyond the shadow of their father's name if that name resists, remains there years from now when they have grown up. You know, I don't like it when somebody turns around and looks at me and says, "Tum bhi daddy ki tarah hero banoge?" Nahi banega. It's okay. Nahi banega.
What explains the change though? In the sense that you've said that you're less able to take the judgments or the narratives that people create about you. Do you
See,
think
when you
that's
have a relationship with someone,
yeah.
Suppose you and I know each other for 10 years and we're sitting and having food and you turn around and say something to me because we have a relationship for some years, you assume that the way I said it, Shah Rukh will know because we have a relationship, right? But if Shah Rukh only turns around and goes to somebody else and says, "What Barka said? Barka said this?" You say, "But Shah Rukh, you know, I always joke like this. It wasn't meant to be." You assume when you have a relationship of 20 years, 21 years, that, listen guys, you know, I can joke like this. You know, I've always joked like this. I've always had this sense of humor. But why is the
but
sense of humor...
But people don't get your sense of humor quite often, right?
Why is it suddenly, oh, he's arrogant? Like if somebody says anything, like you said that, you know, if you ask me a question, I can answer it with a joke. But it's a joke. Now, don't make it out to be something that is arrogant or self... It's narcissistic and bratty or stupid. No, I'm genuinely, and I'm not trying to clarify my position, but I'm a very humble person. Whoever has worked with me, they will tell you this. That I'm a very humble person, but I speak my mind and have a lot of fun and I joke about things. But if you want to, if you take all my jokes and put them in one column and say, read them, he's so arrogant, yeah, they can read like that.
A lot of people want to know how much of winning the IPL was a moment of personal vindication for you, given all this that had happened along the way.
Every time I lost IPL, and when I say I don't mean to take away from them. I'm just taking personally because I happen to be a part of the team.
Yeah.
Every time it happened, I always felt that I will win it once and I'll be vindicated. After 3-4 times it became, I'll be vindicated. I'm going to prove to the world that I'm not a loser. This is all personal, not as a team. Some people might say I'm taking away the credit from the team. The winning is completely because of the team. Everything that happened is because of Venki, Jay and the team. I'm the logo, you know, I'm the guy who does the cartwheels.
The court jester.
I'm the court jester.
Yeah.
I genuinely believe that I am going to be vindicated. I will show people that I'm a winner. And I have not got this wrong. I want people to know that I never, I can run a company in the way which is not about films. And I wanted to prove it to my kids as a father that when your father says things are going to be right, they will be right.
But it took 5 years.
It took 5 years. Every year I went to that match, every match with that belief. When I smiled too much, some people said, oh, he's behaving like a fool. When I looked seriously, they said, oh, he's very depressed. It wasn't either. It was just that I needed all these five counts to be corrected. Last over, 9 runs. I don't remember anything of it. It's the first time in my life I was in a zone. And I got on top of that railing and I believed I can fly. Honest to God. I'm very disturbed. My sister and my daughter and my wife and everyone stopped me. Because I knew I could fly at that point of time. And I would have been the first human being who's not in the serial heroes who could fly. I would have flown, okay? They didn't allow me to fly, so I'll never find out. The match finished. I hugged everyone. I loved everyone. I found out what happened in the last 6 balls. I didn't know Manoj Tiwari had the winning run. And he told me, bhaiya, maine mara aapko kaha tha jitaunga IPL. So I said, I'm really sorry. I was in the zone. I came to my room. Everybody went away. I slept at 8 in the morning after watching the match 5 times. And I got up at 9 o'clock. And nothing mattered. No vindication. No proving to anyone. As a matter of fact, I suddenly also learned that if I'm wrong telling my children something, and if their father is not right and proven wrong, that's also all right. I have never experienced this, that I have no feeling of wanting to do anything after this victory. I am completely, I told my household, I was sitting there, I said, I'm empty.
It's an adrenaline crash also, isn't it?
Nothing. No. I'm all geared up to shoot and play football just now. But I don't want to... I feel nothing. I don't feel vindicated.
So you're able to say that now. Have you lost?
I don't know.
You don't know. Yeah.
I don't know.
But in that moment, when you go down to the grounds and you sort of do the cartwheels and you speak to the commentators, in that moment, is there a sense of, okay, everybody said crap about me, everybody wrote me off, and now I'm here.
If I had a sense of that, I would say it. If I had a sense of that, ki now tell me, was my team good or not? All I do is chamo chalo. All I do is a cartwheel. But I'm expressing happiness.
But why did you stand there and decide to off the cuff sort of say, I'm sorry to my fans and my children for what happened at MCA? Did that moment make it possible or easier for you to say
that? No, somebody asked me if you had lost, would you say it?
Yeah, would
you? If I'd lost, I won't go for the interview.
I'm spoiled. Of course you would.
I would not. I go home.
You're not that spoiled.
I'm very spoiled.
That's spoiled?
I'm very spoiled. I'm a kid. Like I told you, I'm a nuisance to my children. I'm a kid. I go away. And it's all right to go away. Why should I give this sporting face? If I don't like something, I don't want to do it.
Dhoni gave a sporting face?
No, they have to. They're the captains of the team. And they have to, yeah. I don't have to. I don't play the cricket. I can just go away. I did. 2 matches I lost. I just went, poop, like that. And everybody, Jay, Julie.
You locked yourself in rooms and
I've locked myself in a room and I've cried. And I said, yeah, I'm not coming out. I'm not coming out. So my friends are walking to theek to. I say, haan, itna bura nahi hu. But I'm not coming out. I'm feeling really sad.
But you know what I mean? There's no part of you that was going, I told you so. For example, when your old friend Saurav Ganguly said after the MCA incident that Shah Rukh's problem is that, you know, he gets emotional and he says these things that he shouldn't. And my advice to him is he should just lie low. And, you know, everything that you've been through with him. Then you win in Kolkata, I mean, with KKR winning
not
without him.
Not once to anyone, to Gautam, to anyone. In the last, and I've never done this. People may not believe it, but I've never gone and told my team, win it because I need to prove it.
No, but after you won it?
No, not to one. As a matter of fact, even I said, I'm empty. You know, it became even unimportant that what do my kids think? There's nothing more important than that to me. I picked up my daughter, I called up my son, and I said, that's all I did. I went into the bathroom, in the changing room. Sorry if that's not allowed in the rules, but I asked everyone everything. Every time, can I go here? Can I not go?
You didn't drag someone to that public toilet to
not
have
yet,
a brawl
not
with,
yet.
Right?
That rule, that idea has come to me now.
Okay.
But I just went inside and I called my kid and I said, Arun, how is it? He said, I have jumped on the bed and broken the bedroom. So I said, that's just like me. I'm just jumping in the stadium and trying to wake it, but it's kind of the same. And so I'm a little kid like that. And I said, are you happy? He says, what do you think? Yes, I'm very happy. He said, what do we do now? He said, that's what I was thinking. What do we do now? So then I looked at my daughter and I said, what do we do now? She said, no, what do we do now? So we didn't know what to do after that. We didn't want to belittle anyone. We didn't want to, say anyone, I told you so. Even when I came home, I lay down in the bed with my 2 kids, took a picture. But I was just woken up, so my hair was standing. So I've restricted, censored that picture. And we don't know what to do. But I don't feel any angst, anger. I never have. Yes. There were times when a few people commented to me that, oh, Shah Rukh Khan does not know how to run that team. I wasn't running the team ever. But it still irked me that I wasn't running the team, but the boys were running it. Don't say that just because I said this yesterday.
You didn't want to say something to Ganguly, who said this about you?
No, I went after him to a match and gave him a hug, and he said, "Kya bhaiya, mujhe hara diya." I said, "Please, yaar, kabhi to jeet rahe, thank you. Will you please come and take a round with me in Eden Gardens? Because, you know, you started us on this." I genuinely say I feel warm. I feel warm like that. I would never say anything. And I see sometimes when I say something, then people get like, "Oh, isne aisa bol diya." But I just wanted to say yesterday, the first thing I wanted to say to everyone is that I feel so sorry that my team, in whatever capacity I call it my team, as a humble owner employee of the team, is actually under too much scrutiny because of me. You know, they get, poor guys must be having a lot more pressure because of me. And I don't want to put any more pressure now. And by, I've never felt like this. I've never, you know, when my team was going to go, I got this video done of their family from all over the world. That is the only motivation I can give them. I said, you know what, you've played for this team for years. You played for your fans for years. Go and play for people that you love. So I got their mothers to speak to them, their daughters to speak, the children to speak to them. That's all I've done for this team. Nothing else, and make a music video. That's all I've done for the team. I've done nothing for the team. I will never take any credit of this team ever. It's been done by Gautam and the boys. And it truly is right. But the other day, I'm so scared to say, somebody asked me, "Do you think Gautam's a good captain? He's the best captain." I said, "No. I'm not comparing him to anyone. Please don't start
a
controversy."
Think he should be the captain of the cricket Indian
team. Please don't compare. That's not part of my understanding or domain to answer. But if you ask me, can Gautam star in a film? Yes, I can cast him in a film. That's my domain. But you know, I got so scared that I'm in touch with him, so I see him dealing with the team. So I just feel I can say that, yeah, he's got great leadership qualities individually, not compared and belittling anyone else.
But weren't there times when you wanted to pull out of the whole IPL altogether?
Never, ever.
Never.
I'll tell you one thing, Barkha, and however wrong, and this is the wrong. Okay, this is the bad guy speaking. I would never, ever, whatever people take it as arrogance, people take it as crisis or whichever stage of age I'm in, I never give up anything if I'm losing it. Ever.
I can understand.
And I
that.
Say this with all the humility of a little kid. I've taught my children this. I've taught my people who work with me this. I've not taught them. I've tried to tell them. I would never leave. Yes, after I win, I can leave it. I'm over it. I'm detached, and you know, it's done.
But are you detached now that you've won?
Done, dusted, delivered. I feel right now. Let the Champions League start, I'll be back. But I'll tell you honestly, I can never, 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 ever in my life leave anything when I'm losing. No. And not because I feel I have the strength to, I'm too good, or I can beat you, I'm better than you. So I say this with that kind of perseverance, resilience, patience, and that kind of humble strength. That no, when I am losing, I'm not going. And I don't say it with, "Oh, I would have never."
No, people I
say,
totally understand.
You know, people write about, he's got the Midas touch and he's the King Khan and he's, I get pressurized by that. No, I'm a struggler. Failure has always made me, you know, success has made me humble. Failure even more. It has not made me an idiot. That, you know what, now I'll hit my head harder against the wall. I say this story to everyone that, you know, whenever you fail, and I'm so glad I failed so often. I'm so glad. That's why I want to succeed so much. And I say this with humility. I tell my son, I tell my daughter, everyone. So I have never, never, ever felt when I was losing that I'll give this up. And when I'm winning, why should I? So it's you don't give up.
You're the only one I know, by the way, with the guts to hug Mamata Banerjee. She can be a tough woman.
And extremely sweet, she is.
Very sweet, but very tough.
She's never been tough with me. From the first time I met her, I think when I hug people, who have good feelings, they let me hug them.
You're the only one I know, by the way, with the guts to hug Mamata Banerjee. She can be a tough woman.
And extremely sweet, she is.
Very sweet, but very tough.
She's never been tough with me. From the first time I met her, I think when I hug people who have good feelings, they let me hug them. When I hug people who have bad feelings, they feel I'm encroaching on this space. I don't know, maybe I should stop hugging also, because it's taken wrongly.
What rubbish?
No, I've been told, He said, Shahrukh, don't hug. What are you doing? It's not, you know, now you have a status. So I said, what? Oh, so if I have a status, I can't share love. And I'll tell you, I've been hearing the political take on it, and it could be true, not true. I'm not part of the politics. But, you know, we were in a new city, and we've had a lot of issues. And last year when we went there, we went every time to all the officials. And we said, you know, all we want to do is just come and make everyone happy with this team. We're not from here. And she's, you know what, I think she's a very simple lady. You know, I was seeing someone say, oh, why is she policing the people? A CM should not do this. Same thing. Why shouldn't the CM do this? A movie star should not do this. An ex should not do this. Today they're saying, I don't think the Prime Minister should have replied to the charges. He should not do this. It's all right. It is all right. If you are in a position where people are listening to you and you want to tell them, it's all right to be happy. You know what? However great you are, it is all right to be human. I saw this program with this gentleman again, talking to Vishwanath Anand's parents. But because he had decided that these parents have to be wonderful, which they are, what a nice answer. What a nice answer. What a nice answer. So if he talks to me as a parent, and if I say that, you know what, my son abused this kid, and I told him it's all right, you're a kid growing up, part of it, wrong, right, good. It's not a nice answer. Come on, it's absolutely all right to be happy. It is absolutely all right to share your viewpoints. It's all right
to be you, whoever you are. Yeah.
Even if you're in position of power.
Of course.
Just the position of, you know, the gentleman kept on repeating, with great power comes the great responsibility. Great power comes great responsibility. With great power comes great responsibility. With great power comes a web and slinging and flying and delivering pizza also. And it's all right. The fact that great responsibility has come, if I see, you know, how often have you met an extremely powerful man or woman from the outside who have you seen and grown up, and when you meet him, he's kindly and gentle. And you say, wow. You know, like I'm not comparing, but the most awesome of people that I've met in this world, the biggest, and you know, you meet them, and I remember, actually, Mamta Di telling me, I went and she says, isko fish la ke do. It is very touching. Here's a lady who runs a government. I'm not talking about the politics. I don't know. But we've all gone, sat down. I wore a jacket. We all sit down. And, you know, we sit like this. And, good evening, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am. Are you kuch khaya? So I said, no. I haven't. You know, I just landed. She said, let's go. Finish la ke do. Chalo. And she's serving all the people. So should I look down upon that?
No, of course not.
Absolutely. So if somebody is happy for a state or a city or a road or a stadium, that, you know, we will bring, I keep telling people, here we are, who have been embraced by the city of joy, if we bring a little bit back, what's the problem? I mean, you know, I want to start a new anti-unhappy campaign. I want to go to Jantar Mantar and sit down. Am I saying politically incorrect stuff?
Of course you are.
Okay. I don't want to go to
Jantar Mantar. Get into trouble.
I was going to say MCA, but no.
Why don't you try
MCA? I'm going to go to the Gateway of India. I'm going to go to Gateway of India.
MCA.
No. I'm going to take permission and go to Eden Gardens. Okay? I want to sit in my garden. I'm going to sit in my garden and start an anti-unhappy drive. You know, like I sit in Bhutan where they have
Gross national happiness.
Yeah. You know, that's what I want to start. I know there are wonderful people talking about anti-corruption. There are wonderful people talking about right governance. There are wonderful people talking about good news. I think I should be that wonderful person who talks, let's be anti-unhappy. Let's be happy. This country deserves to be happy. People deserve to be happy. You know why? Because we don't get it too often. So my whole logic is that in trying to be happy, as long as we're not hurting anyone, not physically, I'm saying emotionally.
Let me ask you in the end, is that the sort of lesson or the takeaway for you from this whole journey? It's a tumultuous ride. If you had to say one thing you've sort of learnt about yourself that you didn't know, what would it be?
I mean, from what has been said, that I need
to get to this point.
I need a shrink.
From your perspective, you look at this whole journey that got you to this point. When you stood there, you won. It's been a 5-year journey. There's been other things happening along the way. You're constantly under scrutiny, and you sit here today, and are you at peace?
No, I'll never be at peace. That's one other part of my...
Because that drives your creativity?
Yeah, you can't be peaceful. Yeah. Do I look so stupid that I should be happy? No, you can't be happy like that.
You have to be angsty to keep...
Yeah, you have to... Not angsty, I'm restless.
Yeah.
I want to keep on doing things. I don't know when I'll stop. I want to wear makeup in the morning and I want to do stuff if I can and not look silly. I'll still try and make things work in my profession, in my life. I will try to spread the happiness that comes because of me. When I find it is becoming awkward, I will not do it myself first. But what have I learned about myself, apart from being nuisance to my own children, is, you know, I think I'm a little anti-establishment. I'm a little anti-rule. And I think I'm a little stupid. Not stupid enough to be happy, but I'm a little stupid, I think, because I say it how it is. And now that the position that I'm in, I should try and be a role model and play the role away from films also. I say it today, I will not be like this tomorrow morning, I promise you. But I don't want to bring sadness, and I really want to apologize to people. I'm not apologizing, you know, everyone will make it, oh, is it to this person, that person, for the behavior, for the behavior. For a guy who's saying that I want everyone to have happiness and spread happiness, I can't behave in that unhappy manner. I don't think I have any justification or reason to be pointing like this with my veins sticking out, abusing in public. That doesn't make anyone happy.
Well, please never become politically correct. That would make you very boring.
No, I'll never become politically correct. I think I apologize for that. And my main apology, because I'm a television guy and I'm a film guy and I'm a screen guy.
Showing your underwear?
No, come on. That's okay. I'm getting older, so I'm exposing a little.
So then what?
My apology is to all the viewers who were subjected to plastic over made up pop psychologists, socialites giving you lectures. That was really, 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 really the worst entertainment of the evening. I think I really need to apologize. You know, just for that. Just for that, I'm going to be very well behaved, that I don't have people who are not ugly physically, but from the heart, to come and speak nonsense on television just because they can, and not let other people speak, interrupting, and saying some strange things. You know, what one lady says? I said, my children or the girl was manhandled. Oh, it's a very serious charge of molestation if Shahrukh is claiming that. But you know, I really don't know much English, but I think manhandling is just handling. Manhandling like that. And suddenly she starts saying, I hope that's a very serious charge, because molestation against a little girl, can he prove it? I didn't say that. I mean, with God, who, I don't think any person in this world, a lady or a boy, should be ever molested. It's I won't even say it as a joke. I remember there was a little piece I was doing in one of the award functions, and I had a joke about rape. Somebody had written, and I read it, and there were 4 or 5 people, 2 or 3 girls and boys, and I remember I got disturbed.
Yeah, of course.
That you can even joke about this. So I would never do something like this. I have that much correctness in me, I don't know. What else to say? I'm trying to think of something.
It's okay. I'll tell you something. That as we end this, you should accept that controversy is never going to be too far from you, and you should make your peace with it.
With controversies? Mm. And I should not answer back and all?
No, you should be who you are. The ups and the downs.
Do you think I will get jailed one day for my behavior?
I don't know.
Close to it? Do you think, okay,
if you follow through with that public toilet experiment,
no,
you're going to jail.
I'm going to jail. Okay, 2 things, tell me. Where will I make it first? To an asylum or to a jail? Or neither, if I control myself and listen to my children?
We'll come back next year and find out.
Thank you.
Where do you think you'll make it first?
I think my only place is to the top, so I'll remain there. Whatever there is at the top, the asylum or the jail, I'll go there.
Shahrukh Khan, thank you for talking to us.
Thank you, Akash.